seeking first, this is the point, seeking first the kingdom of God. And everything that I intend to say today is linked to that, seeking first the kingdom, seeking first his dominion. And in regard to the White House and the property and its renovation, paying for it and so on, we began by planting a seed, each one of us. If you chose to participate, we planted a seed, and we're asking God to bring forth the crop. And I am leading you and to call those things that be not as though they were, thanking Jesus for all the money. The bank doesn't agree with us that we have all the money. In Jesus, we do have all the money. In the bank, we're waiting for the bank to come into agreement with what Jesus has given to us. So seek first the kingdom of God. Practically, that's a phrase, if you've been to church, you know, a little bit, especially Baptist, and a lot of us have Baptist a part of our background. Part of our training has been in the Baptist church, seeking first the kingdom of God. Practically, how do you do that? I think it's the second slide. I've listed these things. So if you do these in your life, and they'll have its own reflection, is do what he tells you to do. So you start, you end up, you do what Jesus tells you to do. The Bible, the scriptures, and however they find expression in your life, whether it's daily devotions or a memorization. Faye, in her early years, elementary school years, and even in her teen years, she and her family were ardent participants in Bible Memory Association. You may not even be familiar with that. You may know it from years and years ago. And there was a tremendous amount of Bible memory that Faye did as a young girl. So it's called BMA. So your exposure to the scriptures may be something like BMA, or you may be every year reading through the Bible. And however God is leading you, that is, you do what Jesus tells you to do. And you've got to include the Bible, the scriptures, in that giving, tithing. I believe you should be giving, tithing. If you're seeking first the kingdom, then giving, you're seeking God first and foremost for your financial well-being. That will be a part of your life. If you're seeking first the kingdom, what will it look like practically through the day, through the weeks, through the months, through the year? Fasting, I believe fasting will be included if you're seeking first the kingdom. And I've put praying. Interesting, in Matthew 6, when Jesus was addressing, he addressed three things that when you do them for the sight of God, not for the sight of man. Depending on which version you read, one is alms, or the first one is alms, or giving to the poor, or broad-based giving, but it has the connotation of giving to people with needs that you see. Alms is the word that I was most familiar with, and it covers prayer. And it's one of the times Jesus explained to his disciples about praying the Lord's Prayer. And the third thing he covered in this very critical list, in which he tells, seek first the kingdom of God, a little later off in that chapter, Matthew chapter 6, the third thing is fasting. It was like, this is an automatic. And I'm speaking on fasting again today, and I'm trying to encourage you to include fasting every week. I'm trying to encourage you this year to fast 1/10 of your meals. I'm encouraging you to give 1/10 of your income. Many of you do that. I'm encouraging you to fast. And oh my goodness, some people may say, I can't do that. Yes, you can. All you have to do every week is fast 2 meals. You eat 21 times in a week. I'm trying to encourage you to fast 2 of them, 2 out of 21. And then every 10 weeks, you fast 1 additional meal, and that will give you a tithe, because technically each week you should fast 2.1 meals a week. I don't know how to guide you or in myself follow. How can I fast 2.1 meals a week? It's so much easier just every 10 weeks to fast a third meal. And if you do that every week, and every 10 weeks, that'll be 5 times, every 10 weeks you fast an additional meal, then technically you got because we have 52 weeks in the year, you got 2/10. It's a part of seeking first the kingdom of God. I believe it's part of the end time calling, fasting. So I'm encouraging you to fasting, talking, confession. Christianity is called the great confession. I should have said confession instead of talking. If you're seeking first the kingdom of God, from my background, my life, Now, Faye and I, well, I won't tell you what Faye is, in my 70s, and have been involved in church my whole life. Thank you, God, for the parents you gave me. Thank you for the home you put me in. Thank you for the wife that you gave me, who was raised with the same kinds of values, has been in church, worshiping God, seeking to do what number one is, whatever he tells you to do. Now, what I'd like to do in this section is I have a 4-minute. Last week I told you I had a 5-minute video. I think it ended up being 8. So I think this one's a whole lot closer to 4 minutes. It's one of my favorite characters of all. It's a guy by the name of Norval Hayes. Faye and I referred to him as Normal Norval. There's nothing normal about Norval Hayes at all. The point of this is it's going to be an expression of do what the Lord tells you to do. Do it. When Norval got over himself, that means being embarrassed, what will people think? What will my family think when Norval, this is his expression, he won't say this in this particular one. He had to get over himself, his fear of people, his fear of what he was going to look like, what will people think? He specifically mentions, though never by name, what will my relatives think? So this is a short 4-minute testimony. The very first words are garbled just a little bit. This took place in Canada. And he was in a church, and it was a church that it was atmospherically, I mean, the temperature that was in the room, not due to the presence of the Lord, but just the temperature, it was hot. And he's going to explain how hot it was. You may miss him say initially he was in Canada. And he will tell you in it that the Lord prompted him, spoke to him regarding an individual who was in the room. And the whole point is, I'm using this, A, I love Norval, and B, it's a terrific testimony, and C, don't miss the point. It's a reflection of do what the Lord tells you to do. An astounding miracle is about to take place, and a process. I have great appreciation for the process, but it begins with the Lord telling him, if such and such takes place, this is what will happen. So this is 4 minutes, Norval Hayes in Canada many years ago. Please, can you play that?
In Canada, in a church, one Sunday afternoon, I never will forget it. They didn't have any air conditioner. I was sweating then more than I am now under these lights. I was wringing wet with sweat. I never will forget that afternoon. And they pushed the man with the wheelchair down. About 40, 50 people came to the altar. And a man with a wheelchair came down. His legs was twisted and crooked. You tell he'd been crippled for 20 or 30 years. He'd been that way for years. You can just tell it. And the Lord said to me, son, what you taught today would work for him if he would obey it. I said, glory to God. I said, sir, I taught, call those things to be not as though they were. And the Lord just said to me that what I taught today would work for you if you'd obey it. Now, look at your crooked legs and call them straight. He goes, what? I said, didn't you hear me for the last hour, hour and a half? He said, yeah. I says, well, obey what I taught. He goes, what? I said, I taught call those things that be not as though they were. God said, it worked for you. Call your crooked legs straight. Look at them and call them straight. He goes, and he wouldn't do it. He just wouldn't do it. I says, well, God told me to work for him if he did it. So I think I'll just demolish his mind. Most people's minds needs to be totally demolished. And so I grabbed a hold of the banners of the church like this, and I knelt down I put my mouth close to his ear, and I said, call your crooked legs straight, 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 sir, call your crooked legs straight, call your crooked legs straight, and I kept on and on and on, and the longer I went, the louder I got, call your crooked legs, and finally, I blasted through his goofy mind. Oh. That's not easy to do with most humans, you know, especially if you've been trained one way for years. And I said, call your crooked legs straight. And finally, he looked at him and he says, I call my crooked leg straight. I said, say it again. I call my crooked leg straight. I call the crooked leg straight. I call the crooked leg straight. I call the crooked leg straight. I says, keep on. And he said, I call the crooked leg straight. I said, thank God. I'm about out of breath. He said, I said, keep on now, keep on. Don't stop. Sarah, don't stop. I begin to back away from him. Don't stop. Don't stop. Keep on and on and on and on. Don't stop. Don't stop. Keep on and on. Don't stop. And he sat there, I guess, for about 5 minutes. And I was ministering to other people over here. I looked around there, and the Spirit of God was all over him. Just, I mean, he was totally saturated, and he had broken, began to cry and weep. And he said, I call my crooked leg straight. I call my crooked leg straight. I call the crooked leg straight. I call the crooked leg straight. I call the crooked leg straight. I said, keep on, keep on. And he kept on and on, and just being saturated by the power of God. And all of a sudden, he just went across the floor. The pastor went. The pastor said he ain't never done anything like that before. I said, he didn't sit there and call his crooked leg straight before either. Romans 4:17 says, call those things that be not as though they were.
Sunday morning, March the 3rd, fasting, part 3. I think it's been years since I've taught on fasting. It's being extremely beneficial to me. I wish I'd understood these things, because through the years I've done a fair amount of fasting. I wish I understood these things from the very beginning. So I'm doing this because I believe this year and the season that the church, the body of Christ, is entering into, fasting, regular fasting, is to be a part of it. The end time global army of God, the Joel 2 army. Fasting was a key part of that Joel 2 army. I believe God's calling all of us. It is a measure of seeking first the kingdom of God. I gave you a list, but it's a measure. It's one of the ways to seek first the kingdom of God. And again, I'm trying to prompt you to have in your thinking, I give a tithe of my income, my resources, my financial resources to the Lord. I fast a tithe unto the Lord to hasten, to enable my voice to be heard on high and to go after the values that God has. It's how you live. So the point I want to make is out of Isaiah chapter 58, the classic fasting passage of the whole Bible, it's how you live. And you want to be led by the Lord. You want to see what the Lord is doing, never knowing all that he has in his mind, but you want to do what he wants you to do. Do what the Lord tells you to do. He wants to guide you. Fasting is one of the things that will, a fasted life, living a life of fasting, and to me, one easy way to do that is to fast a tithe of the meals a year. And all you have to do is fast 2 meals a week. Plus, every 10 weeks, fast a third meal. Anybody can do that. I did Seeking First the Kingdom. I did that list. And so, in fasting, just as a quick review, this is not the point. In the midst of Isaiah 58, God led Isaiah to explain what's not the point in fasting. And I read this last week. Is it a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is that what God was saying? Is that what I'm really looking for? Is that whatever degree of inconvenience, whatever degree of discomfort that you may experience? Because there is some measure of discomfort in fasting. The longer the fast, the more things you'll tend to deal with. Is it to bow down his head like a bulrush? Is that what God is bowing down, a biblical way of worship? It's a very biblical way of worship. I do not believe the Lord was coming against bowing down before him, bowing your head like a reed blowing in the wind or like a bulrush. But is that the whole point? The posture that you take, though worshiping God in that posture, is very biblical. Is it to spread out sackcloth and ashes There are several times the scriptures are very clear that people in desperate circumstances spread out, put on sackcloth and ashes upon them as their desperation to the Lord. And would you call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord? Is this what it's all about? The momentary discomfort, maybe extended discomfort. Is that what it's about? No, it's not what it's about. This is the point. And last week I emphasized this verse, Isaiah 58:6. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? It is the purpose. It is the intentions. And it's fascinating to me in this chapter that God points what are really his intentions, why Jesus came. And as you're fasting, there's so many things that you can be faster. Like it could be an Esther fast when you're all facing extinction or something like that. Obviously, seeking the Lord and his safety and deliverance is a very valid thing to fast for. But if you're doing something like I'm encouraging you to do, and that is fast, you're doing Matthew 6, you're doing three things that Jesus talked about in the chapter where he explained, seek first the dominion of God. So he said, when you fast, don't do it for other people to be aware of it. Fast in secret. Well, when you pray, pray in secret. When you give alms, do it in secret. And God who sees in secret will reward you. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness. That may be in you. And that may be why you're fasting. There are things about you that you've come to regard as, I don't want this. This is a reflection of wickedness. I am asking that the bonds of wickedness in me be broken. You may have family members that you pray for. That's a very, and you may have set aside a fast to pray for. And what you might do during your meals is instead of concentrating maybe on what you're not doing, what you're not eating, you may use that meal time as a special time to pray for families, children, the things that God laid on your heart, the things that God has called us to do as a people. You have families, and so you could pray through verse 6 of Isaiah 58, or just one of these things, to loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens that could go along with it, but there may be heavy burdens. That what is the heart of God? When Jesus announced in Luke 4:18, this is why he came, reading out of Isaiah, it was for those things, to proclaim, to preach the gospel to the poor. That's why he came. To proclaim deliverance for the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those that are bruised. That's what he read. That is why he came. So it's like, what is God, what is his real focus? What is his real intent? And he had Isaiah include this in this path. This is what I'm looking for. So as you're fasting, the point is not to concentrate on what you're not doing, what you're not eating. That's not the point. The point is that it hastens you. I don't know if your seriousness, your purposefulness, your intensity, it hastens that. And these are Isaiah 58:6 is a great thing to let the oppressed go free, to pray these things, and that you break every yoke. You could focus on that for the course of this year. Is take one every week, take one of those things, and pray it for whatever dimension, whatever expression, in addition to the other things that you do. So, going on, this is how it might look. If you do that, based on Isaiah 58, if you do those things, what might it look like? And there are some practical suggestions that are given in Isaiah 58, and they are this, verse 7. Is it not so to share your bread with the hungry? So what might it look like to the burden? You're lifting the burden. You're letting the oppressed go free. You're breaking every yoke. What could it look like? It could look like you share your bread with the hungry. It could be that the money that you would have spent on those meals, you look for someone that you know is really struggling, and you can do it in secret. You just can send them a letter, and you could not a check, but you can send them money, wrap it in paper a couple times so they can't tell there's money. And here, the Lord laid on my heart to give this to you, and be blessed. You could do that. You could share of your bread with the hungry, and that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out. Now, the feel of all this to me is it's how you live. That fasting is to be a part of how you live. All of these things, they find really more of an expression in this is what you do in an ongoing basis, or this takes a bit of time to do this. It's not going to be done just in a one-day fast, typically, and that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out. It tends to be, that's going to be for a longer time period. And when you see the naked, that you cover him, I would do that quickly, and not hide yourself from your own flesh. That means your relatives, your friends, your children, your cousins, your so on. Don't hide yourself from them purposefully, meaning it's intentional that you're keeping yourself away from them. There are reasons that aren't really good reasons. But that's a practical expression of how can you do those things, breaking the yoke of separations, breaking that yoke that's between you. It goes on. God is not a thief. He's not trying to take from you. God is looking for ways, I'm convinced, that he can bless you. There are some people that are raised with a theology that what God is doing is he sees you as a diamond in the rough, and he's got a hammer and a chisel, and he's hammering and chiseling on you, and he's knocking off all the edges. Do I believe the Lord is involved in discipling us and in guiding us without a shadow of a doubt? Do I think some of those lessons and some of those time periods are difficult lessons? Absolutely they are. Do I think what God's intent is, as sometimes it's painted, I'm trying to knock off all your rough edges. And so if that's how you frame it in your thinking, then you see God mainly, he's trying to knock off all my edges so I don't have so many rough edges. So you see God as mean, cruel, as oppressive. I'm not acceptable to him. I prefer to see God as what I find in my own life and as I see in the scriptures is that he has destiny and calling for us. And when we come into this world, we can be a long ways away. I was a long ways away. There's a significant part of my life that's already been invested in Russia, and there will be more, and out of Russia there'll come great reward. The first time I heard someone invited me from our congregation who was here at that time, this was years ago, this would have been 1997, 98, 99, in there. Pastor, I want you to go to Russia with me. And I remember I looked at him, his name was Jim, and I said, Jim, I have no interest in going to Russia. We're involved in Guatemala at the moment, and we've got so many villages that we need to visit, and we'd visit 5 to 7 or 8 a year. We've got so many to visit in the Patan district. I don't want to go to, I don't have any interest in going to Russia. God's opened up a doorway for us in Guatemala. It's been a long time since I've said this. And I had a bad attitude about that because I thought, we've got this calling in Guatemala. We have all these villages that we have not gone to. We are having great impact. Why would we divert from that? So when I got home, I went to Faye for a little bit of comfort, and I told her, Jim's wanting me to go to Russia right now. We've got all this work in Guatemala, and I used this phrase. I said, he's trying to differentiate too quickly. It's just not right. And Faye kind of looked at me and said, wow, most pastors would be glad they had people in the congregation who wanted to go to other countries. I said, thank you, Faye. I won't come to you for counsel anymore. I was not in a place. There was a lot of work on that the Lord needed to do, training, discipling, and had to go through renewal. And that would have been before 95. That took place. I gave you the wrong time period because renewal hadn't happened yet. So this would have been in the early 90s, between 1990 and 1994 is when that event would have been. I did not want to go to Russia. And what God had, that's my name, Russ, means a part of Russia. I didn't know that. I would find that out. There's so many things that I would find out, and that God had called me to play, us, a strategic role in the end time revival, of which Russia will be a very significant part. I had no idea that. And when that was materializing, I was just standing as steadfast against it. So that was part of Jesus' training as he was working with me, moving me along. And the point of focus to me is, because he was moving me so that I would be in the place that I would fulfill the calling, and it would be incredibly fulfilling to me, and it would build such, in my life, such significance that God chose for us to be a part of this. And what he was doing, he was discipling us. He was moving along, training, educating, teaching, giving experiences, because he knew what he had for us. That's how I view God. He's not a thief. If he calls you for things, it's not because he wants to steal from you, because fasting is a fundamental part of the Bible. And Jesus, in speaking on the passage, the classic passage of seeking first the kingdom, he explains that God's not a thief at all. Is what does God want to do? How does he want to bless you? So I've listed them ahead of time. In your seeing, and I mean your clarity of what's going on, where am I in life? How clear is it to me, the path that I'm on, your ability to see? Or is everything so confusing, it's like walking in a dark hallway? I don't have a clue what the Lord has on mind. Think about fasting. Your health. Let's just say there's significant need in your health, and you need your health to spring forth speedily. You have sensing of there are things before you. You need that. Think about fasting. Your health springing forth. Your priorities and character. You want those to be in line. And God, you want him to dispense such grace to you that your priorities and your character are as you desire to walk in the image of Jesus, be changed in his image. Your protection, things you don't even know that are coming. You need the kind of protection where someone who knows everything that's about to take place, and he, as you create openings for him to be able to function more fully in that capacity on your behalf, fasting. It's one of the promises of fasting, that the gift of righteousness that he gives to us that has come because of the gift of Jesus, that we can walk in that, and that goes before us. In essence, it's the shield that will be in front of us. Yes, I know there's the shield of faith. There's the breastplate of righteousness. But in Isaiah 58, it's all lumped into your righteousness shall go before you. And the theme of that is the protection will go before you. It will be righteousness. It will be the things that you don't anticipate, that you don't know, but God does. And he is watching out before you. His presence, and it's his glory will be your rear guard, is what it says. That his presence will, the things that you can't see behind you, he will be your rear guard for those things. How is it said? This is verse 8. Then your light shall break forth like the morning. You'll see. Then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your hearing, even that incident that happened this week, you would say, well, that was an obvious, Russ. It's not an obvious to everyone. You get a phone call canceling a date for the use of the building, and then 5 minutes later you get another phone call for the use of the building on that date from somebody you didn't even know existed. No, it's not an automatic, but as you live your life, and if fasting is a part of your life, that's one of the promises, then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your ability to see what you need to see for your life. Your healing shall spring forth speedily. So if it's the need of healing, and your righteousness shall go before you, it's the protection, in essence, is how you live, your right standing with the Lord, how you interact with people. Your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. It's what shall protect you from the backside. It goes on. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, here I am. The focus is on fasting. What not to do. what it's not, what it is. What are the values that the Lord, that they are the values of God. They're the core values to break every yoke. The cords, the bonds, to loosen the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens. That is the character of the Lord. And then you shall call and he will answer. You shall cry and he will say, here I am. It's the way we live. Fasting, these promises, this application is how you live. I am trying to guide you as I live. I'm trying to guide you to live in addition to a giving lifestyle, a tithing lifestyle, seeking first the kingdom of God with a tenth of your resources, seeking first the kingdom of God with a tenth in the course of a year of your meals, in a context where so many people say, well, I can't because I have to take medicine. I have to do that. Come on, it's only two meals a day, one day a week. You can do that. The way we live, the focus is the way we live. The rest of Isaiah 58, 9b, if you take away the yoke from your midst. So that's the point, is you take away the yoke. So what the yoke, the oppressiveness, the way you're approaching life, or where you have the opportunity to remove the yoke, or you have the prayer opportunity to pray about that, and if you take away the yoke. So that's what I'm focusing on in my prayer, is that the yoke be taken away. And the pointing of the finger, so that's our judgmentalism, which we're all guilty. And some weeks of the year, we're more guilty. And some weeks of the year, you're probably less guilty, unless it's the flavor of your life. You're judgmental as the flavor of life. The pointing of the finger is as you fast, you have graces that enable you. And if that's one of the characteristics of your life that you don't like, the pointing of the finger, then that can easily be. And that's a bondage. That's a bond of wickedness. Judgment. God's the judge. We're not. I do understand it says we're to judge the fruit. I understand that. The pointing of the finger and the speaking wickedness, all of us would agree with that. The speaking of wickedness. And if we'll do away with those things, well, that's living. That's daily. That's how we are living our lives. The point is, this is about how we live. If you extend your soul to the hungry, okay, extend your soul to the hungry. I don't carry cash at all because I extend my soul to, I'd spend it. I just spend it. So I can't pull a dollar bill out of my wallet because I don't have a dollar or a five or a 10 or a 20 or a 15. I don't have it. So, but you encounter a person, this is not extending your soul. It is. So let's say there's a 10. I don't have any cash. So let's say there's a 10 and you see our five. And you take someone in, and you're not sure how they'll spend the money, so they're hungry. So I had that happen, years ago, let's say 8 years ago. I was in the Home Depot parking lot, and a man approached me, and he knew who I was. I didn't remember him, but I certainly knew family members of his, so I recognized that. And he was begging for money. And he was telling how hungry he was. And right across the street was Arby's. And I said, okay, I'll take you across the street to Arby's. I'll buy you a meal at Arby's. Which I did, because I felt like that's probably a wiser use of that money. So I did. And I invested a little bit of time. If I'd poured out my soul, I think I would have, okay, let's sit down. Let's talk. Let's talk about your life. What do you need the Lord to intervene with? What are the things that I value that are so meaningful to me? I'm going to invest in you in addition to this $5 I bought his meal at Arby's. If I extended my soul, it's more than you just buy a meal and walk away. You invested some of your being, some of your person, some of yourself. And you could say, that $5 was incredibly precious to me. Okay, I can buy that. It's the statement that if you extend your soul to the hungry and you satisfy the afflicted soul. That means these are longer than shorter investments. These are investments where, out of your being, you are genuinely seeking to relieve them of what they are dealing with. How to fast. Okay, you want me to fast 2 meals a week and every 10 weeks fast 1 meal, and I'll fast, and I do that all year long. That'll be a tithe of the meals. What do I do? Take Isaiah 58. Take verse 6. Pray those things. Read those things. Study those things. And everything else the Lord leads you to. But pray those things. And it goes on, then your light shall dawn in the darkness. That you're seeing. You'll see. Your capacity to see. And your darkness shall be as the noonday. That's a great amount of darkness to walk in. It's like it's noonday. I don't like to walk about in darkness. And if it's as bright as the noonday, that is wonderful. There are promises to the fasting. And it's a life. It's a life where fasting is a part of that life. Guidance. What will he offer to give you? And God's not a thief. He'll offer guidance. He'll offer provision in desperate times. You may find yourself in desperate times. Internal strength, treasures. He'll offer you treasures. Internal strength, what I'll call treasures that he gives you. And stability. He offers you stability. A fasted life. Fasting. Not focusing on the fasting. Focusing on what are your values. I'm seeking those first. There first. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And so here's where he says it. Isaiah 58:11. The Lord will guide you continually. You'll have guidance. And satisfy your soul in drought. And provision in desperate times. And strengthen your bones. He'll give you strength within. That's a treasure. There are people who have just taken that verse and strengthen your bones. There's a couple in the Andrew Womack testimony about a family in Ireland. Yes, in Ireland that had a son with very deadly stage 4 cancer. And they found a verse like this as a part of their journey about bones. I don't believe it was Isaiah 58. I believe it was another one of the passages in the Bible. But it was like this kind of treasure that God, you may be dealing with a bone problem or bone issues or internal, or you need to be strengthened from within. You just need to be more sturdy to withstand things that are just normal and happening around life, around the world. Then there's these treasures that are placed within the scriptures, and he'll strengthen your bones. It's like a treasure waiting, because you may need strength for your bones. That's a great thing. God, this is what you've promised. To those who are fasting, your values. Unto, for those purposes, you'll be like a watered garden. That means it has plenty of water for everything that's growing. And so that's growing, so that's time for what's growing. You'll be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fall or fail. That means you'll have a constant supply of water, even in times when there's not a lot of rain and when there's normal amount of rainfall. You're like a spring, so the waters never fail. And there's long-range impact. Why should I even think about fasting? That's a pretty good list of promises and blessings that the Lord gives. I mean, that's an amazing list. And then there's a long-term list. And it's out of this that I find the strength to live and to suggest to you, let it be long-term. Let fasting be long-term. Just fast a tithe. Just a tithe. That would be 2.1 meals a week. That can be done. But what's the long-term impact? Because this last verse before the last several verses, 2 to 3, deal with the Sabbath. What's the long-term impact? Living life, his way of living life. What's set in motion? That takes a while, years. It is, those from among you shall build the old waste places. That means there are things that are broken down in life that God's intention is for them to be restored. And it may be you and those among you, it may be those You are nurturing, you're discipling, you're training, you're raising up. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. That means they'll restore them. You shall raise up the foundation of many generations. The investments are the many generations that may follow. Yet, if time goes on, the many generations that follow, or impacting many generations, you shall raise up the foundation of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, things that are broken down that people would believe they'll never be restored again. A fasting lifestyle, it's how you live. If you think financially, I guarantee you that somewhere early along the line, you will think tithing. You think tithing. You're giving the Lord a tenth. And fasting is when you are saying no to the flesh. You're saying that fundamental, significant, delightful need that I have to eat. I'm saying you are second place. I'm seeking first the dominion of God. So for these two meals, or however many, there are some in the congregation that are going to begin tomorrow a 40-day fast. So whether yours is 40 days or whether yours is two meals a week, 2.1 meals a week, you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. So how to live, where to live, what street to live on. So to speak, meaning by that, that's the location, that's where you are, that those are the values that you have. The street, the place you are living, which is fundamentally, we do here what the Lord wants us to do. We seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So those are the blessings that the Lord intends, fasting. So I'm saying, join us. For this year, we did it last year. For this year, I am. The first Sunday of the month, this is today. Then generally today, starting with the evening meal, I encourage you to join me in a three-day fast. You may say, I can't do that. Or you may do a weekly fasting tithe, which I've spoken of before, or during the course of this. And focusing on Isaiah 58, focusing on God's agenda, living a fasted life, seeking first the kingdom. That may be what it is for you for weeks. I want to seek first the kingdom of God. What it will look like practically, I read that list to me. What I believe is a very biblical listing. Is it complete? No, but it reflects the life that God has led me down. God's agenda, the fasted life. Going after, what do we fast? Going after unbelief, our unbelief. Going after the White House and the property. Going after the global harvest that I believe is just before us, and it is ever. I'm done. And everybody said, unbelievable. I know, that's what you wanted to say. Well, I have a 15-minute closing, so. No, I don't. You can give a tithe. Faye and I have for so many years, and we are convinced it is how God is sustaining us. It's how we built the house and we paid for everything. We just paid for everything. Does that mean you earned the money for everything? No. They came as gifts, they came as teaching that would, and then just ridiculous amounts of resources that would come from one night of teaching at a place, just ridiculous amounts of money. Given that time in history, it was ridiculous. I could come home with a $500 offering. There might be 25 people there. This was many years ago. It was ridiculous amount of money. And so we just bought. But we named it. As we have named this thing, we name you paid for, renovated, in Jesus' name. Everybody with me. We name you paid for, renovated, in Jesus' name. There'll be a team up here who will be glad to pray for you. So I'm urging you to join me either in this 3-day fast. You may be joining a group that's starting tomorrow, a 40-day fast. And I urge you to do this week a 2-meal fast and let it be, pardon? Oh, and let it be every week. Isaiah 58. Let me pray for you. Father, thank you for what you're doing. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. In Jesus' name, your kingdom come. Your will be done. As we embark on fasting life, thank you for your promises that you have so abundantly given to us. And we would honor you in these things. And I bless this congregation and those that we have prayed over, Lord. Health spring forth speedily in Jesus' name. And I bless everyone in this room. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Going to begin the series on healing again on Wednesday night, 6:30 to 8. I encourage you to come. And there's prayer tonight. Starts 6:30 to 7:30. We start right on time. We try. 95-98% of the time, we start exactly at 6:30. And we end at 7:30. And it's a little fluid there, but not much. So if you have a chance to go visit Elaine, I wouldn't today. She's in Tonova North. Or to call Barbara Meyer on the phone. Just pray, wish her well. Tell her we prayed for her. Or Otis, just encourage him. And if you see Faye, just give her a word of encouragement. Bob Cox, he loves visitors. And in his swanky rehab facility, you'll be glad you did. If you've never seen a swanky rehab facility, Well Park over on Middlebrook Pike is where Well Park is. Have a great day. You're dismissed.